Continuing from where we left off before, we actually have grouped all of the machine components into their respective containers as shown in this specification tree. So we have these six containers from fixed component X motion, Y, Z, B, C motion, and we also have introduced a fixed constraint applied to this fixed component container. So now we are continuing our process to include more constraints to our assembly. We will start with a simple constraint for this rotating table. We have B and C motion, both are involved in rotational motion later in the future. Okay, so we are going to introduce coincident constraints between these two components. This is coming from a B motion container. This component should be coincident with this component from the fixed container. So this one. So we have fixed constraint there. Coincidence constraint between these two components. So the next one is we're going to introduce offset constraint between these two surfaces. Okay, this orange colored surface from the B motion container is constrained to this yellow pale color surface from the fixed component. So we will leave this value as it is because we don't want to change our machine configuration that we have from the original step one. So that is the position. Okay, we will check. The relative or we will check the degrees of freedom for this component B motion. The way to check it is by right clicking on B motion container there and go to object and then check the component degrees of freedom. See here that the only degrees of freedom left unconstrained is in this rotational behavior there. So it can still rotate. Okay, it can still rotate along these edges. Okay, that is how it's supposed to be. So we will leave this unconstrained. Okay, now we are going to constrain this rotating table or C motion component in relative to B motion. So similarly, we are going to use this coincidence constraint between this C motion axis with the axis from B motion. Okay, this axis. Okay, and then we also going to introduce the same offset constraint between this planar surface here from B motion, and then we will constrain it to this planar surface from C motion. And similarly, we will leave this value as it is. Okay, just click on OK, and then we check on the degrees of freedom for C motion object. Okay, make sure that there are two rotational degrees of freedom. Rotation one. This rotation one is inherited from the degrees of freedom coming from B motion, and this is the rotation that comes from the C motion. So combining both of them, we have two degrees of freedom for this table, which can rotate along this axis and this axis. Okay. So we finish with B motion and C motion. We're going to introduce some constraints for X motion. But to do this, I have checked this assembly model. This surface and this component is actually overlapping, so we cannot use this coincidence contact or contact constraint. So we need to do some modification to the model, but it's really minor. If you can follow my step, you will be good to go. So the first thing is we need to introduce two geometrical feature to two components. One is this black part here, and one is this gray part here. This black part is coming from X motion container, and then this gray part here is coming from the fixed component. So we will do this for this black component from X motion first. The way is right clicking on the black part surface here, right click it, and then select center drop so that you can be directed to the children of X motion component directly to its 3D part here, this part. So we are going to introduce another geometrical set. It has one geometrical set over there, but we want to introduce another one. So just click on double click on this 3D part first, so that you go into generative shape design or part design workbench. If you are inside part design workbench, just change your workbench into generative shape design, because we want to create a geometrical feature. Okay, I am already inside the generative shape design. So within this workbench, I'm going to insert a new geometrical set. Okay, so this is the new geometrical set. So inside this set, I'm going to create one line and one surface. Okay, this is the process that I'm going to do for creating the line. So you can click on this line icon from the right toolbar, and then for the line type, choose point direction. Okay, what is the point? The point is going to be a midpoint. So right click on this dialog box or fill box, fill for point. Right click and then select create midpoint, and then over your mouse over the edge of the part here. Okay, see the preview of the middle point there by green color dot there. Just click on the edge. So that is the point created for you, which is a middle point of the curve selected. And then the direction, click on the surface of this black part so that the new line will be created perpendicular to the surface. The rest of the features or the rest of the values remain as it is. Just click OK. Okay, now we have the line. Okay, from this line, we are going to create a new surface. So select the line by clicking on it, and then select extrude icon from the right toolbar, this one. So just click on the extrude icon. This is the extrude surface dialog box. We have the profile line one selected. Now just want to define the direction, so we choose the same edge that we used for creating the middle point earlier. Just click on the edge. So this is the new surface created by this operation. The rest of the values just remain it as it is, and then just click on OK. So now we have these two geometrical features, one line and one surface. We are going to do the same operation over this gray part here. So similarly, just right click on this gray part there, and then click on center graph. So this is your part. Just double click on the part name. And similarly, create a new geometrical set, but in this case, we already have an empty geometrical set over here, so no need to create a new one. So just follow the same process, create a new line, point direction, and right click on the point field, create midpoint, select the same edge as before, this one. Although this edge is coming from this black part from X motion component, it doesn't really matter, because the objective is we want to create this line and surface coincidence or in the same place with each other. So just click on this edge. Okay, and then the direction, similarly, just click on this black part surface, and the rest of the values just remain as it is. I will show you why. Okay, once we click on that edge, previously this edge is coming from this black part from X motion. So what CATIA did is it creates a datum feature over here. So if this black part from X motion got moved relative to X axis over here, at either to the left or to the right there, this curve or surface will remain as it is. It doesn't move along with this black part from the X motion component. It's just a reference for us to create our constraints later. So now we have this line, and then we are going to create one surface. Similar process as before. Okay, we have the line selected. Now just specify the direction. Similarly, we click the direction, not from this edge, because we already clicked this edge before, and CATIA creates for us the datum, right? So this one is the datum, curve one. So instead of clicking on this edge, just click on this datum curve that is created by the this process. Okay, the rest of the values, just leave it as it is, just click OK. So we have this surface. See that this line is coincident with the line from our first process to our first line in X motion component is coincide with each other, and this surface also falls in the same place. Okay, now we have these four geometrical features. We go back to the main assembly. Okay, double click on the main assembly. Okay, now we are going to create similarly coincidence constraint. Okay, so for this one, I'm going to collapse all the branch. Okay, so we are going to create coincidence constraint between the two lines. Okay, this line is, notice the highlighted portion from the product specification tree. When I hover my mouse here, X motion got highlighted, meaning my cursor right now is ready to select the line from X motion container. So just click on it. So the next click should be selecting the line from the fixed component, but I cannot do that because it is overlapping. So what we can do is we can hide X motion first. So just hide X motion. So this line here is the line inside the fixed component container. So we can click on that line. So one coincidence constraint got created between those two lines, X motion and fixed component. Okay, without showing the X motion component, we go and create another constraint between this surface from fixed component, and then show the X motion component again, and then click on the surface from X motion. If it is hard to click, just hide the fixed component and then click on the surface from X motion. Okay, so make sure the offset value is 0 mm and then click OK. Okay, now we check on the degrees of freedom for X motion component. I will show my fixed component. Okay, so right click on X motion and then go to object and check the component degrees of freedom. We should have only one translational degrees of freedom, which is going in this direction. Okay, left. Okay, now that's done. So we move to the Y motion. Okay, I have checked my model previously before we start this video. And I found out that for Y motion and X motion component, it is not overlapping. So what we don't need to create the lines and surfaces for this activity. We can directly create our coincidence constraint between this edge from Y motion component. Okay, and then I will hide this so that I can select the coincides edge from X motion component here, so it creates my coincidence constraint correctly. And then I create another offset constraint between this surface from X motion component, and then I show back my Y motion component and select this face so that it has a 0 mm offset value. So click OK. Okay, now we check our Y motion degrees of freedom. Right click on Y motion, go to object and click on component degrees of freedom. It should have two translational degrees of freedom. One is inherited from this one. This one is inherited from the degrees of freedom coming from X motion component, and this is the degrees of freedom from Y motion component itself. So close this. We are going to create the constraints between Y motion component and Z motion component. To do that, I will first hide my other component that is not associated with these two components right now to make things easier for us. Okay, so right now we only see these two components from Y motion and Z motion. Okay, now again, I have checked my assembly here. There are a lot of overlapping issues between these two components. So what we're going to do is we need to create two lines and two surfaces similar to the process that we did for the relation between fixed component and X motion component. So to do that, I'm going to use this component. So right click on the component and click on center graph. So this is the 3D part. So right click on the part, reactivate it, and once you double click on the part name, you are directed directly into the generative shape design workbench. So now we are going to create a new line. Okay, so remember that we need to create this line and surface inside a geometrical set instead of this body. So in this specification tree, I have an empty geometrical set here. So I'm just going to use this. I'm not going to create a new geometrical set. So to use this, I right click on the geometrical set name and then click on the define in work object. So it got highlighted or it got underlined there, meaning any feature that I'm creating right now will be inserted into this geometrical set. So click on the new line, okay, select point direction, and then right click on the point field, create midpoint. So just click on this edge, okay, and then the direction is by this surface. So this is the new line that is created. The rest of the values just leave it as it is. Okay, by using this new line, I'm going to create a new surface. Okay, that line got selected as the profile, and then specify the direction. This direction, I'm going to select the same edge that I used previously. So this is the new surface. Click on OK. Alright. Okay, now we finish with this part. Now we have got this is coming from Z motion component. So we need to do the same process for Y motion component. So for Y motion component, I'm going to use this component here. So I will right click on the component there and click on center graph, so it get directed into the part directly. So double click on the part name to activate it. Okay. We also have an empty geometrical set inside this part, so we're just going to use this. Okay, now we are going to use the same feature that we used before, which is this edge and this surface. Okay, so just create a new line, point direction, and then right click on the point field, create midpoint, and select the same edge as before. Okay, and then the direction, we select the same surface as before as well. So just leave the rest, click OK. Okay, by using this new line here, I will create a new surface, and then instead of clicking on this edge, we already have this datum created. So just use this datum curve, and we will have the same surface and same values. Okay, now we go back to the main assembly there. I will collapse all the other branches just to make sure, just to make our view not so cluttered. To do that, I'm going to go to view and go to create expansion and click on collapse all. Okay, now we can create our two constraints similar as before. So click on coincidence constraint creation, and then over my mouse over this line, the line that is ready to be selected is coming from Z motion. So I click on that line, and then I hide Z motion for me to easily click on the line from Y motion. Okay, and then I click on this offset constraint from the Y motion surface here, and then I hide my Y motion and show my Z motion and click on the surface from Z motion. Okay, make sure the offset value is 0, click on OK. Okay, now I will make all the other components visible again by showing them, and then rearrange my view to be isometric view, fit all in. Okay, now I want to check the motion of my Z motion component. So I click on the Z motion and go to object, click on component decrease of freedom. So we should have three translational degrees of freedom. Okay, This one is coming or inherited from Y motion, degrees of freedom. Okay, this one is inherited from X motion, degrees of freedom, and this is the degrees of freedom related to the Z motion component. Okay, now we have these three degrees of freedom, and remember from the C motion, from C motion degrees of freedom, we have this 5 degrees of freedom, meaning a total of 5. From C motion we have these 2. So a total of 5 degrees of freedom. That's why we call this machine as 5 axis. So the next step is to arrange our full machine assembly here so that it is in home position. Okay. I will open my web browser. Okay, and then I will search for this machine brand name. This one. Okay, I have shown this web page before in the first video. So in the first video, we actually click on this 3D model to download our model. Now we are going to use this feature on layout drawing. So clicking on layout drawing, it will show us the layout drawing of the machine. We have a total of 6 pages here, but not all are relevant to our course right now. The one that I want to view right now is the axis clearance, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, this one, right, X and Y axis clearance. Okay, this is still not the measure. What I want to see actually, okay, this one, Z axis clearance at V 0 degree. Okay. So we have this value, minimum and maximum. So we are going to put our Z spindle according to this maximum Z clearance, which is 508 mm. So we are going to do that. Okay, the value just now, 508 mm, is measured from this top surface to this spindle surface here. So we will create an offset constraint between the between those two surfaces. Okay, from this surface and to this surface, the value should be 508 mm. Okay, now enter. So update our assembly. So once we update our assembly, notice that the Z spindle is moved up. Okay, it moved up according to this value, 508 mm. Okay, now I will show this assembly in relative to front view. See that, notice that our Z spindle here is not really aligned to the center of our turntable. Maybe I can show you here. This is the axis from the turntable or from the C motion component, and this is the axis coming from the Z spindle. You see that there are some distance over there. This is the total distance. Can you show me? Component. Okay, this is the component distance in x direction or x axis. It is displaced by this much, and in y axis is what we are going to rectify right now. Okay, in y axis it is displaced in this value, 15.757 mm. So we should have this zero, this value as 0 mm. So how can we do that? Okay. So first, what we can do is we arrange this turntable component first. Okay, what I meant here by that statement is doing this activity. Okay, if I look at this turntable from the top view, okay, notice the planes are not really aligned properly. Okay. This is quite slanted at a certain degree, so we want to have it perpendicular or parallel to at least this edge. And then see, notice that the orientation of the turntable is given as this configuration in this diagram. But in our 3D model, it is slanted a little bit at an angle. So we want to have this plane here parallel to this edge. So how can we do that? Okay, now with all the planes from the turntable component shown, we are going to create an angle constraint, and then the plane that we should select is this plane. Okay, this plane. Okay, be sure to select the correct plane. Okay, this plane here, it should be parallel to maybe this planar surface. Okay, by this default assembly, it is at 80 degree. So just change the value to 0 degree. Click OK and update our assembly. So right now our turntable is aligned properly. Okay, looking at the top, looking from the top, we can see that this turntable configuration is similar to our layout diagram here. Now we can align our Z spindle here so that the Y value that we measured before, 15.7 something mm, we can change it to 0 mm. Okay, now unlock this. Okay, I'm going to introduce offset constraint between the axis of the spindle here with this plane. I'm going to zoom in a little bit just to make sure I'm not selecting the wrong plane to this plane. Okay, see, this is the value that we have measured before. It's 15.757 mm. So we will change this value to 0 mm. Enter. Okay, and then we update our assembly. Okay, that is updated. Okay, now looking back to the layout diagram, we want to know the value for Y motion. How to constrain our Y motion here? Because right now our Z motion component degrees of freedom, it can move by this direction. Can move in this direction, so we want to fix this by a given value or non value. So we have this y-axis travel limit, okay, a total of 406 mm, and it goes symmetrically 203 mm over that direction, 203 mm over this direction, and it is measured from the center of the turntable diagram. Okay, now what we want to do is we want to introduce another constraint, which is this offset constraint, and then we're going to select the spindle axis and then constrain it to this plane. Okay, right now it is at 203. So we will change this to minus 203 mm. Just click OK or enter. Okay, update our assembly. So now when we check our Z motion again, we check it, component degrees of freedom. Okay, so there is no more degree of freedom for Z motion, which is our objective right now. So this is the home position of the machine. We assume this as the home position of the machine. I don't really have the full spec of the machine, so I don't have the home position data. But if you have your own machine and you have the detailed specification for that particular machine, you must follow the home position location, home position or location of the machine, and set it properly during this analysis process. Okay, the next step is actually introducing the kinematics, but I will do that in a separate video. I try to limit my videos approximately around 10 minutes each, because otherwise the size got too big for my system. So I will see you again at next session.